Hello and welcome to the first lecture on Introduction to Algorithms. Today we will try to see what are some motivational reasons to study algorithms. So one of the main reasons to understand how things work is to see what are the real world phenomena that we would like to study. It turns out that many of the real world phenomena that we encountered in our daily life have a strong CS connection to them, and here are some examples. So one example is how do we schedule various jobs with various parameters, right? So for example, you may want to schedule so that the average time or average latency or overall time, overall latency, these are minimized. These kind of scheduling problems often arise in situations such as computer networks where you know a packet waiting time, packet arrival times, these have to be looked at carefully so that the end-to-end experience is smooth. Similarly, you could also think of game engines where one what I'm referring to here is, in particular, suppose you have a machine that can actually play chess with humans, which has been achieved as far back as the 2000, and it turns out that current generation game engines are really very competitive when playing with even top level human players. So what kind of algorithms are going on inside these game engines? How do they understand to play the game? How do they play the game? These are real interesting questions from an algorithmic standpoint. Similarly, one can think of program translation, which means that you are able to take programs from a high level language and convert them to a language which is eventually understood by the computer. In fact, if you recall, computers understand nothing but zeros and ones. So the high level language, a program in the high level language, has to be converted to a strings of zeros and ones eventually. Not only that, modern compilers can actually introduce several optimizations which a human eye could have easily overlooked, and these could mean a order of magnitude performance in some cases. So what kind of algorithms are really playing behind in these compilers that can not only translate from one language to the machine language, but also introduce various optimizations that improve the performance? More recently, the IBM Watson is a standalone system that would actually compete with humans in a live game show. In fact, it won the game show, beating a contestant that has been winning for the past 10 years. So that's a remarkable achievement. Given the fact that this machine did not have any internet access during the quiz show itself, right? So all it could have as a resource is all that is stored on the computer and all the programs and whatever thesaurus, dictionary, reference material, but it had to come up with answers to these quiz questions which are not known a priori, and it should be competing with humans in a live quiz show, which is kind of remarkable. Okay. Anyway, so what is our interest in all of these examples? We want to understand what is the kind of processes that go or that run behind these examples actually. Similarly, how do we design and analyze such solutions? You know, what kind of techniques are required? What kind of building blocks are required to create these solutions? Also, importantly, once we understand piecemeal solutions, we should be able to generalize and ask, are there common methodologies that kind of bind these solutions together? Or given a particular nature of problem, how do we realize that, okay, this particular methodology might apply here to come up with a good solution? In fact, a more deeper CS question always has been, can we do any better or can we not do any better, right? So can we argue that no better solutions exist, right, in any sense, right? And in a similar spirit, we could also want to understand things like, are there similar problems with respect to their difficulty to solve? So are there problems that are of the same difficulty to solve or that are of different difficulty to solve? How do we argue and how do we reason about these differences? Similarly, at a very, very abstract level, are there limits to what computers can do? Right? So for example, can they solve every problem that we face today, or are there natural limitations that stop them from solving problems that are possibly solvable by human brains but not by computers? So how do we argue that such problems may exist or may not exist? So what do we know about that? So these are some early thoughts that we should be trying to figure out during the course of this lecture, right? In fact, along with solution methodologies, we would also try to understand what are some common analysis techniques that bind these solutions, how do we understand the correctness and optimality of these solutions, and so forth. So the course will tentatively is divided into several paradigms, or study of several paradigms, right? We'll start with paradigms such as divide and conquer paradigm, where the solution is composed as solution to smaller problems, right? So that is a natural way of driving solutions. The other paradigm that is common across solutions is what is called as dynamic programming, which is applicable in a wide variety of settings. Whether it leads to an optimal solution or not is a different question, but can it be applied or not is something we could always think about. In fact, the other more commonly applicable model is the greedy algorithm design, where you are kind of trying to understand if there is a common local greedy choice that will affect or that will influence the way the solution is designed. Right? In fact, to make sure that we understand these various paradigms carefully, we'll try to study two or three examples from each of these solution methodologies so that we know when they can be applied, in what context do they apply, how do they apply, and how do these solutions look like. So what is the common thread that binds these problems and solutions? And of course, we'll also study some algorithms for graphs, given that graphs are an all-pervasive data structure and a representation format. We should be able to relate to several problems on graphs, such as matching, network flows, and shortest paths. Finally, the last module of this whole course will talk about lower bounds, complexity classes, P, NP, completeness, reductions, which try to relate or try to put together problems of a similar difficulty or problems of a different difficulty class. How do we reason that these are difficult, some of them are easy, these kind of things. At all times, the intent will be to see what kind of real world examples can be identified that match to these problems or methodologies that we talk about. So for example, one of the first paradigms we'd try to understand is the divide and conquer paradigm. In this case also, some of the real world examples that we'll look at is the multiplication of large integers, which has applications to contexts such as information security. So for example, when the size of the numbers that you wish to multiply crosses the limits of what a computer word can store, you need to identify different techniques to multiply numbers, to take their powers, to take their modulo, these kind of things. So we'll try to see how divide and conquer approach can help us in this model, in this problem. We'll extend this case of integers, which we can think of as a scalar quantity, to the case of matrices. Matrices are basically what we deal with are 2D arrays of numbers, but suppose we'd like to multiply them. Again, this is a very popular, let us say, computation on matrices. The standard one takes time proportional to the cube of the size of the matrices. But when you apply divide and conquer, along with other techniques, it is possible to reduce the time taken from n to the 3, where n is the size of matrices, to n to the 2 plus epsilon for epsilon between 0 and 1. So therefore, it is interesting to see how a simple approach like divide and conquer can be applied to a very basic problem such as multiplication of integers or matrices. Then we'll try to move up the scale, try to define what is known as the skyline points in a 2D point set, understand applications where these points are of interest, and also design an algorithm using the divide and conquer approach to come up with a solution to finding the skyline points in a given 2D set. So again, these are example problems, and we'll try to include several, let us say, supporting materials such as notes, illustrations, slides, examples, and question banks, and pointers for further reading. So all in all, this should give you a very comprehensive experience to understand the algorithms behind the examples that we talk about. So that is a basic motivation to why we should study algorithms.